AS Producciones presenta Cara a Cara con Rosalía.
Bienvenidos, queridos amigos, a este nuevo programa en el que tenemos realmente un invitado espectacular. Se trata del señor Mohamed Yunus. Quiero presentarlo muy brevemente porque lo que más queremos es escucharle. Él nació en Bangladesh en el año 1940, recién celebró su cumpleaños número 80 y es conocido mundialmente por haber creado el Banco de los Pobres. Ha sido galardonado por varias oportunidades con el Príncipe de Asturias, también el Nobel de la Paz por su lucha por la economía de los más pobres. Él está actualmente en su casa en Bangladesh, en Dhaka, y desde allí coordina también la distribución de alimentos a 100.000 familias esparcidas por todo su país que morirían de hambre si él y su equipo y su grupo no colaboran con estos ingresos para las personas. Voy a hacer la entrevista en inglés, la vamos a subtitular y tenemos mucho placer en empezar este diálogo con el profesor Mohamed Yunus. Welcome, Professor Yunus, to this interview. We are very happy that you accepted from your home make this interview. I am in my home and the team is all in their homes because of the pandemia. We are not allowed to work together yet in Ecuador. But thank you very much for accepting this invitation.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here with you, talking to you in Ecuador. I'm in Bangladesh. I love that country, Ecuador. I visited several cities there. I had a wonderful time, but I couldn't make it to Galapagos, which I wanted to, but we didn't have time to come back.
Let's see what happens. Let's see what happens in the future with this
this
pandemic and how we surpass this. I will want to ask you some things about your childhood, how you spend in Bangladesh, and after a little bit how you get involved in these initiatives that led you create other initiatives. Then we start when you were just a small kid. What were you during this time? How was your family?
Yes, indeed. I came from a very low-income family. I was born in the village, so I grew up in the village. Went to school first time in the village. Then my father moved to the city to set up a small shop, and he brought the family with him, and that's how I came to the town. And then went into local school, which is where all the low-income family children went to school. So that's how my schooling began. But luckily, as I grew, my school performance was good, so I got to get to a better school. And that's my schooling. But I had a lot of other interests while I'm in school. I became Boy Scout.
It was something very important at that time,
to be part of
Boy Scouts and have that discipline and all this.
That's right. And for me, the important thing about Boy Scout, I got a chance to go to various Boy Scout rallies, jamborees. So I went to Canada as a Boy Scout, as a team. So for the first time when I was a 15-year-old, I went to Canada in Montreal to have the Boy Scout Global Jamboree. So I met lots of people. And we had fun going there and coming back. And the coming back,
and it opened your eyes to the world, probably.
Absolutely.
Because when you travel, it is so important for people.
Very important, very important. We traveled by ship from New York to Southampton by ship. So that was fun by traveling, but to save the money from the airfare. Because air flights at that time, that was 1955, was pretty high. So we thought, why spend the money there if we go by ship? We have plenty of time.
A long, long trip.
Yeah, long trip, 15-day trip.
But it was part of the adventure.
Absolutely.
Fantastic.
Then we bought three microbuses from Germany and drove those microbuses through Europe overland to come to Pakistan, where it was my country at that time. So that was 6 months traveling through many, many countries. This is after the Second World War. So you see, this is 1955, world was over 45, just 10 years after the war. So you see how the war devastated countries and the people and their politics.
When it awakes your interest about economy, because you have a degree in economy, and it's important to know what moves you.
That's right. And as I was in school, Pakistan was a newly created country after the British left the subcontinent. The subcontinent of India was divided into Pakistan and India. So everybody is worrying about such a poor country, how to improve the quality of life, so extreme poverty everywhere. So that, as a student, you continuously talking about those, and the politics always talking about this. So we become interested in economics. So I studied economics, and I got a Fulbright scholarship to go to the USA to do my PhD. So I got more. Then I came back. By the time I came back, it became a different country called Bangladesh, which was a part of Pakistan. Yes, different.
Yeah.
So, and I was very excited because I wanted to have that separate country. I was in favor of getting out of Pakistan. So I was very excited, but the economy of Bangladesh went down and we had a famine. And I was teaching economics, and you see people hungry all around you and people are dying of hunger. So that's when it hit you, that what good is economics if you cannot help people?
And you think how economics can be a tool to help and to improve quality of life?
That's not how I felt. I thought economics was a totally useless subject because it didn't equip me to help people, because all the theories I talk about has no meaning in the life of those hungry people.
Yes.
So I thought I learned something which is useless and made me useless person. So I wanted to see if I can be useful to people. So I started going to the village to see how I can help people. And among many little things, I always try to do little things so that I can at least help one person. I was not trying to solve the problem of the country or the problem of the region.
One person at a time. Yeah, it's important.
It's very important. That's when I got very interested in the problem of loan sharking. People take small loan from a person, a loan shark, and the loan shark grab everything that you got in the name of the loan. So I see terrible stories all around the village about the loan shark. Then I thought, how do we protect the loan sharks? How do we protect the people from the loan sharks? So one idea came to my mind, why don't I start lending money myself? If I lend the money, then the person doesn't have to go to loan shark, so he's protected. So in 1976, I started lending money to people in the village so that they don't have to go to loan shark. So that's the thing which started growing and growing. And finally, I thought I should create a bank out of it, a small bank for the village, and call it Village Bank. And in Bangla, it's called Grameen Bank or Village Bank, same thing. And
it
became so popular.
And one thing that I believe, because I read about you, is the interest about women
and
how women possibilities to increase the level of the family through women. Tell me a little bit more about what do you think about the role of women in to improve the economy of the family.
Well, women at that time in Bangladesh was nobody in the family. She is totally ignored, she has no right, no voice, is the husband, is the all in the family, and husband will beat her up, husband will make her starve for something that she didn't do, so it's a very cruel kind of societal arrangement. And she couldn't leave home, she has to stay home all the time because of our religious, so-called religious restrictions that you cannot go outside. So that's not a very... a life which women could enjoy. The reason I got involved with the issue of women is, again, I was attacking the banking system. I said, banking system is designed completely wrong way. It lends only to people who already have money. So I said, it's very funny. This bank is created to provide money to people, but it does do it in a funny way. It lends money to people who already have money. and it doesn't lend money to people who don't have money. I said, it should be the other way. It should lend money to people who don't have money. And after they do it, they do it the other way. They laughed, banks didn't pay any attention. Then I said, the bank is another funny thing, because it lends only to men. It doesn't lend money to women. Mm-hmm. I said, all the borrowers of banks in Bangladesh at that time, 99% of the borrowers are men, not even 1% women. So I said, what a funny thing. I'm not talking about the poor women, I said, about the rich woman. Even she doesn't get a loan because she's a woman. So I said, that's absolutely wrong. So when I tried to create my own bank, I thought these are the two things I must change. I should give the money to the people who don't have money, give the money to women also. And I made sure.
It is fantastic because it changed the mentality of a banker, a normal banker or a traditional one. And you have to change also the laws, the conception about how. What are the conditions that you make it for giving the money?
Exactly. So I wanted to make sure half the borrowers in my program are women. So this is the first time. It's a small work. We wanted to have women equal to men as a number. But it's very difficult to convince the women. It's not men.
They probably doesn't have self-confidence also.
Absolutely,
that they can do
you got it. They have no self-confidence. They are so afraid of money. They thought they will create trouble in the family and the husband will be angry with her. So she doesn't want to get into trouble. Her life is all about trouble. All the time is trouble. So she thought this is creating a new trouble. So she will stay away. And when my students who were working with me, the girl student, because I cannot go to women to talk.
You were teaching at
the university, yes.
Yeah.
So I'm working with my students to help me. So I took my girl students to talk to the women because they will not allow me as a man to go to them. So they will say, when they go, the women say, oh no, I don't need the money. And they are so afraid when they enter the village, they literally run away. They are coming to give you money, so stay away from them. So they were very upset. My students were very upset. They said, oh, there's no use of giving money. They are so afraid of it. I said, look, it's not the women this is not the women's voice that you hear. It is the voice of the history which made them. Her life is made of all fears. So our job is to peel off the fears layer by layer. Someday real person would emerge and say, maybe I should try. And if one of them tries and makes it successful,
it will make
then others will be interested. Yes,
yes. Really exciting. And a very wise way to introduce this idea of having or giving money to poor women.
To women.
We must make a stop and then we'll continue with this conversation.
Please,
thank you.
Thank you.
Mel Reasco, tenista ecuatoriana ubicada en el ranking 21 ITF Junior, ya tiene el plan 20 sobre 20 de Ecuasanitas en el 2020. Con cobertura médica de $20,000. Chatea al 0999-86-2020. Más de 40 años. Ecuasanitas, lo bueno de estar sano. Afíliate.
Aún no hemos vuelto a la normalidad. No se confíen. Si van a salir, lleven siempre su mascarilla y úsenla bien. Yo soy parte de la población vulnerable y aún no me quiero despedir de mi familia.
No te confíes, la pandemia aún no termina. Manos, mascarilla, distancia. Conoce las medidas de seguridad y los puntos de atención en caso de contagio en www.guayaquilviva.com.
Evitemos estar en contacto para volver a estar juntos. Paga de forma segura usando tecnología contactless. Además, tus vouchers no requieren firma. Es cómodo, fácil y rápido. Utiliza tus tarjetas Banco Pichincha con tecnología sin contacto. Banco Pichincha, en confianza.
again with Professor Mohamed Yunus. Thank you to continue with us in this interview. Professor Yunus, you were talking about the difficult and how it was hard to break some traditions. But also you demonstrate with this bank that you have profit and it was not going directly to bankruptcy. Because true. Probably you, some people were thinking that, okay, you give money to the poor people, for the poor woman, and you are going to have no money back. But what happens with that? It was an interesting story.
It is very interesting story because the conventional thinking was completely wrong. They always thought you cannot give money to women, and we gave it to women. They always thought that you cannot give money to poor people because they will take the money and eat the food and never be able to pay you back. So they said, so you'll never see it again. And they've been proven wrong. People are working with the money. They start a business, raising chicken, raising cow, raising vegetables, doing handicrafts and paying you back. So they created a series of activities rather than just eat the money. And they pay back. So Grameen Bank became known as a bank for near 100% repayment without any collateral. We don't have any collateral. We don't have any legal papers. So it's based on trust.
Yeah, in trust. Such an important thing.
Very important.
Especially these times. Important. Yes. And you provide some kinds of advice also how to manage at the beginning.
We don't do that because we tell them that, look, we don't know anything about your business. We know how to give money. You will be the expert of your business. So don't come to us for advice. Go to your friends for advice. So get them connected to each other. We had no idea how to raise a cow or how to raise a chicken because we went to school pretty different. Nobody told us how to raise a child. We are not in a traditional village family. So we saw the urban life and so on. And most of the young people who work for us, they are university people, university students. So they have no idea what the village people live. So I said, look, don't look at them for your advice. They will give you wrong advice. Don't listen to them. You listen to people who are raising chicken, raising cows.
Yes,
raising
and you manage your business.
Absolutely.
A lot of trust and a lot of confidence.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
How long it takes when you create the Grameen Bank to go to other cities and to grow the concept and the idea to grow, especially in Bangladesh, but also in different countries, because you have grown such in a big way. I want to know a little bit more about how it grows.
It is step by step. If I'm working in this village, neighboring villages, please come to our village. We need it. So we said, okay, we'll come to your village. So we go there. So it expanded gradually and became nationwide bank very soon. And we had no problem with money because we got an official bank. We became a licensed bank. So we can take deposits. So we're in the rural areas. We are the only bank in the rural areas because all other banks are in the cities. So people who needed to keep the money in the bank, we are the only one. So they put their money in our bank. They will withdraw the money from the
city. To stimulate banks savings also.
Exactly. And also we accumulate money. The savings. So we had plenty of money. Wherever we go, we said, if you start depositing money with us, we'll start our business. So we had no restriction in terms of shortage of money. Most of the time, we had the problem of surplus money. We have lots of money, but we still have not been able to find poor people to lend the money. So that's a kind of, so this is one part. Money was not a problem. So we could quickly go because there are plenty of poor people around. Then we continue to do that. Since we are focusing on women, that slows that down because everywhere we go, the first thing is always a hesitation. No, not me. Give it to my husband. We say, not to your husband, to you.
No.
So it takes a lot of time to change the mind from husband to myself. That how can I take this money? And it takes, it's a kind of shifting the entire thinking of the women because they cannot believe that they can handle money. And they become very good handler of money. So that's another thing. The deposit work and payment work. And we made enough money to cover all our costs. and had surplus. But we had no intention of making personal money out of it. This gave us a new idea. Later on, today we have a big campaign, what we call a social business. Yes. We define social business as a business not to make money, but to solve problems. It's a zero personal profit business.
It is a different philosophy.
And very different philosophy.
How long did you stay with the bank? Because I understand that you are not more in the Grameen Bank,
no more,
but doing other
right,
kind
yes.
of things. How long it, it lasted, right. this period? And how was it to be recognized worldwide with prizes like Nobel Laureate and also Prince of Asturias and...
Yeah, many prizes.
Many prizes. How you
many
feel
prizes.
About that? Because you did it, but how you feel?
Exactly, yeah. At that time, we are not looking at the prize or anything. We're just doing things. But we didn't realize that we did something nobody thought it could be done. It was such a news for everybody. People always had a suspicion that must be something he's hiding. So they will come and study, dig things, and finally they become totally convinced that it is something unbelievable. So it became a big news everywhere. So people keep coming to visit us.
Talking about it.
And then they want to do it in their own country. So today it's almost every country in the world. There is a program called microcredit or microfinance or Grameen program. So we work in all over Latin American countries. We have programs in Brazil. We have program in Mexico. We have programs in Colombia. Many places in
and
Chile,
they are separate
in
initiatives, and they are separate initiatives in each country, or it's they are like branches.
It's a local initiative.
Yeah.
Only we do. We train them. They come to Bangladesh. We go through them. They go through our process and so on. We keep in touch. We became good friends, and we visit them, and they call themselves Grameen such and such, Grameen Colombia, Grameen Argentina, Grameen this. Because they see Grameen, it's immediately people understand.
Yeah, but it is not that it's a big international bank, but they are separate initiatives
with
the same philosophy. Because it's also different from other banks.
Absolutely. It's a philosophy they share, the methodology, procedure, how to do it. So they follow the same procedure because it works. Now we work in the United States and called Grameen America. And we work in 14 cities in the United States. We have nearly 200,000 borrowers, all women, 100% women. And they have been doing it for the last 11 years, lent out over $11 billion so far in total. And the repayment is near 100%, 99.5%. And most of them are Latinos who have gone to United States, very
because
poor.
Because they are the poor.
Absolutely, they are the poorest.
Also.
And they have no documents. They can't speak the language. So all our staffs are Spanish-speaking staff because they have to work with them.
Yeah.
And they don't have any documents to prove who they are. But we lend them money. We have no problem.
Yeah, and there are limits to the how much money they can get?
In the beginning, starting has a limit that you have to start with. Usually it's under $1,000 in the USA. With under $1,000, usually $700, $800 and so on. That's the beginning. Yeah. And for them, that $700 look like a huge money because nobody gives you a penny. And they come, no papers, nothing, and give you all this money. And you start a little business.
You continue now link it with this initiative or it is in other hands?
Yes, in many places I'm on the board, honorary board member or honorary chair. To respect this kind of thing. So we keep in touch with each other. And many of them have continuous visits and train their staff here. We make the visits and develop new programs for them, etc.
Yeah,
so it's all over Europe.
And you don't feel tired? And
no,
want
exciting.
To stop it's ever?
It's very exciting thing to do. It's not a question of tired. It's very exciting. And you see, no matter what language you speak Spanish, you speak something else, French or something, but you still say this talk, spirit is the same. You can immediately understand what she's saying because it's the same thing you hear in the village of Bangladesh, you hear it in Oaxaca, Mexico, or Chiapas, Mexico.
It is fantastic.
Same thing.
But you are involved now in other initiatives. We want to know a little bit about the other initiatives because I know that You are providing food in your own country. Right. And tell us about other initiatives.
We did the Grameen Bank as a lending institution, but then we saw poor people have so many other problems. So we started creating separate businesses. We started with healthcare for women. Women has terrible health situation in Bangladesh at that time, particularly child care, but pregnancy and so on. Women die at the childbirth. So we tried to create a healthcare system as an independent system and made it into a business so that it covered its cost, charge very small amount of money, but cover the cost. And that is spread. We have health centers created, and we create a company called Grameen Healthcare and started giving healthcare, and then give insurance, health insurance. You pay each borrower, Grameen Bank borrower can pay $4 a year.
A year?
$4.
My God, yeah.
And entire family is covered under health insurance, entire family, not just one. So it works because everybody has this $4 insurance. So we collect this money and appoint a doctor, full-fledged. They never saw a real doctor because you always have the village doctor, quacks, which has no qualification and so on. This is a real technically educated doctor, live in the village, and we have the support staff, the health workers and so on. We have the medicines, we have equipments, and we cover the $4.
And it is amazing because all health insurance, they are very expensive in the world. And maybe some of them, they go to bankruptcy and say they don't exactly have enough money. But you say $4 per year,
it
is a cover, and you are not losing money.
No. We can't lose money. Then
what's the secret, Professor Yunus? What's your secret?
How you design it, that's the important thing. For example, one branch of Grameen Bank has about 5,000 borrowers, one branch. If one branch, everybody has insurance, $4, you have $20,000 because everybody is giving $4. So you have $20,000. If you have two branches covered by one health center, you have $40,000. With $40,000, you cover everything.
For primary health or...
It's primary health?
Not like hospitals or that, but
no,
only
we don't have
primary,
we don't
primary
have,
health.
We don't have hospitals. It's just a primary health care. All the testing, all the lab, we have that. So we can do the preliminary...
It sounds great. I hope and I wish that we have something like that in Ecuador and in Latin America.
Absolutely,
because we are needing, especially these times. But we are going to make a small stop and then continue to talk what do you think about coronavirus? But after us, thank you.
All right.
¿Por qué pedir siempre la misma comida a domicilio? Descárgate Glovo y pide de cualquier restaurante de la ciudad una buena hamburguesa, el mejor sushi o tu pizza favorita. También puedes pedir las compras del súper, regalos, farmacia y mucho más. Glovo, lo que pidas te lo llevamos. Aprovecha combos a $4.99 con envío gratis todos los días.
Ahora más que nunca, sabes que cuentas con tu banco para cuidarte a ti y a los tuyos. Puedes solicitar tu tarjeta de crédito Pacificard para hacer compras en línea, abrir una cuenta de ahorros y mucho más desde tu celular a través de la app Onboard BDP. Recuerda, cuentas con tu banco para hacerlo todo desde la tranquilidad y seguridad de tu hogar. Tu banco, tu casa. Banco del Pacífico.
Estoy tan orgulloso de ti. Has llegado muy lejos, has mantenido siempre tus principios. Eres imparcial, objetivo y sincero. Has aprendido lo que necesitas saber. Sigue adelante.
Así es, Diario La Hora. Llegamos cada mañana con la mejor información en el tamaño ideal. Diario La Hora, lo que necesitas saber.
Esto no ha pasado. No se confíen. Hay muchas personas que ya se están reuniendo y no respetan el distanciamiento. Es muy duro afrontar la pérdida de alguien que aman. Yo aún no la supero y creo que ustedes tampoco podrán.
No te confíes. La pandemia aún no termina. manos, mascarilla, distancia. Conoce las medidas de seguridad y los puntos de atención en caso de contagio en www.guayaquilviva.com.
For staying with us in this very important and interesting talk with Professor Mohamed Yunus, Nobel laureate, but also a person that's still working very hard and having some ideas probably for these very hard times that the world is living. Professor Yunus, you know a lot more about what's happening with this pandemia of COVID-19. What do you think about it and how you envision the world after coronavirus?
Yeah, two things I've been doing recently. One, I just sent out an appeal to all the countries, all the newspaper, to make the corona vaccine as a common good, as a global common good. Nobody should own vaccine. Ownership should not be there so that anybody can produce it and distribute it. Lots of people, lots of world leaders have signed with me. About 110, 111 people have signed. So it's now we are campaigning for making corona vaccine as a global common good.
Yeah,
Important. It's very important because at the end of this year or the beginning of next year, vaccine will start coming. But today, all the rich countries are buying up the vaccines. They're already paying money, big money, so that the companies will only sell it to them. Two companies already declared their first production will go to the United States. One company declared. Another company declared that all their first production will go to Europe. So I said, what happened to us? When do we get it?
And what happened with Latin America? Because we are
what happened to Latin
really
America?
Affected with this.
Absolutely. So I said, no way. So vaccine cannot be owned by a company. Vaccine should be like a sunshine. It's for everybody. Anybody can produce it.
And maybe the wealthy people in the world has to pay for it. The wealthy people has to make an...
So it should be free. It should be free for people who cannot pay. So there's nobody should be excluded. Nobody said, okay, I cannot pay, so I cannot get... No, everybody will have that vaccine. So this is what we are doing. And we are, and the second time, we are saying that as long as big companies start owning this vaccine, then people will never get it. Poor countries,
leaving that thing of the vaccine that we hope and we pray that it's going to happen in this way. But what other measures that governments has to put on floor? How wealthy people can help? What do you think about this opportunity to create a new world, a more effective world for the people?
That's right. That's the second issue that I continue to talk about. I said the coronavirus has done us a great favor. It stopped the economic machine. I said that economic machine was creating a lot of problem for us. Before the coronavirus come, we were about to finish this whole planet by global warming.
Yeah.
So we are very close to the finishing line. So there is no reason why we should go back to that point again. So I said, coronavirus has done us a great thing. It has stopped the train, which is rushing to go to a cliff and fall, finish. I said, now coronavirus has stopped the train. We can get out of the train to go back to the train and finish off our life, or we now create a new train to take us someplace else. So this is our choice. Number one, the global warming. Number two, wealth concentration. All the wealth of the world is in the hands of few people. 99% of the wealth of the world is in the hands of 1% of the population. I said 99% of the population has only 1% of the world. I said, what kind of economy is this?
And
this is a crazy thing.
It's a big asymmetry in every country.
Yes.
Yes, and it is not sustainable in the long term.
Yes, it's of course not sustainable. It's a mockery. It's a mockery of a system. And it's a ticking time bomb. it will explode because people will be so angry that the whole social fabric will be torn apart. I said, that's not the direction we want to go. Wealth concentration. Luckily, coronavirus has stopped the wealth concentration. There is no wealth concentration now. The machine is not working. So that machine is contributing to the wealth concentration. And the third one is artificial intelligence. It's coming in a big way, moving people out of jobs. Massive number of people will be out of job.
Yeah, that's happening now in every
it's
country.
It's already happening.
Every day we are losing jobs because economies fall down, and also this artificial intelligence new situation.
Well, the pandemonia has created this pandemic has created a situation where all those weaknesses in the society are revealed very clearly. How the poor people are very close to extinction because they have no income, they have no job, everybody is sitting there. And how the wealth is distributed in a very unequal manner. All the wealth is concentrated in a few hands. 99% of the wealth goes to 1% of the population of the world. See? So this is the kind of anomaly that we have. And there are tremendous amount of efforts, what they call recovery, meaning they want to go back to pre-corona situation of the economy. I said, why should we go back? That world was not a happy world. It's a very unhappy world. It's a terrible world. That world is about to kill us, destroy us. So why should we go back there? There's a problem of global warming, which is going to kill us. There's a problem of wealth concentration, which is going to kill us. There's a problem of massive unemployment because of the artificial intelligence that's going to kill us. So there is no way we can survive if we go back to that world. Today, we should be grateful to coronavirus. It gave us a chance, opportunity to go different way. Create a world. There is no global warming in that world. In that world, there is no wealth concentration. Wealth is shared by everybody.
And you are optimistic about the thoughts of the people because you are a dreamer. And of course, you get some dreams come to real world. But how we can make the mentality of people change with this situation that we are living now, and to create this new world with more opportunities for everybody?
First of all, it's a very concrete situation right now. I don't have to argue about it. I said that if you go this way, it's a suicide. Would you go for suicide or you try to survive? If you want to survive, you have to do different things. You have to do things in the opposite way. All the problems are created by fossil fuel industry. So if you want to create a new world, you have to stop the fossil fuel industry and go that way. This is very clear because we know where this global warming is coming.
But some people and some people that make decisions, the decision makers, they are not with this spirit of change the world because of the profit that they made, and they are thinking in profit. I go to some supermarket in Ecuador now, and I feel that the value of the things is increasing instead of feeling more solidarity and say, okay, the people is starving. We need to make it more available for poor people. But it's not true. How we can convince them? Maybe your voice and other voices are saying, but how we can make it real, possible?
That gives me a courage because I started giving loans, small loans, to few women in one village. Everybody says it's wrong, but I'm alone. Now it's worldwide. So if you do something, everybody says it's wrong, everybody says you're absolutely destroying the whole economy, you're destroying the religion, you're destroying the society, you're destroying the family by giving money to women. Everybody was opposed. But it became a worldwide. So I said, if you have a right word, the right message, people,
it comes true.
So don't give up. I'm saying don't give up. And the children are demonstrating on the street. All the teenagers in your family, in my family, all the teenagers are on the street saying, Friday is for future. It's already convinced. It's your family, it's my family.
I have a lot of confidence on young people. Sure. What can you say to young people in this program, to young people of Latin America, to young people of Ecuador? How
very
that can make the difference?
Very simple thing. I'll tell the young people, look, you are blaming your parents' generation because they have been irresponsible. They had created a world which is going to kill you. Now this is your chance. World has stopped. Why don't you stop this world going back? That's in your power. You can stop them. And make sure that it goes in the right direction. If you do this Fridays for Future, now the future is yours, number one. Number two, you are the most powerful generation in human history. Because all the technology that you have in your hand, no other generation ever had
this. The connectivity with everybody.
Connectivity. Absolutely.
The world is one, yes.
Absolutely. That you have, no other generation had. Ask yourself what use you are going to make of this power. If you have the power, you have to find out what use you make that power for. Don't sit there doing nothing. If you don't do anything with your power, it will be just wasted away. You had the Aladdin's lamp in your hand. You never touched the Aladdin's lamp. And genie never came out. Now it's your chance. You have the Aladdin's lamp. You are the Aladdin's lamp. You are the genie. Go ahead and do it. It's your chance. And coronavirus gave you a big, big opportunity.
Yes, and there is no other chance because we are wasting the time.
Absolutely.
And we waste it.
Yes.
And then we need to improve now, not tomorrow.
Not tomorrow. This is the time. So that's the message for you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much.
We are happy to have you here and
delighted.
Thank you to everybody.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Daniel Pintado, campeón panamericano de 20 kilómetros marcha, ya tiene el plan 20 sobre 20 de Equasanitas en el 2020. Con cobertura médica de $20,000. Chatea al 0999-86-2020. Más de 40 años. Equasanitas, lo bueno de estar sano. Afíliate.
¿Por qué pedir siempre la misma comida a domicilio? Descárgate Globo y pide de cualquier restaurante de la ciudad. Una buena hamburguesa, el mejor sushi o tu pizza favorita. También puedes pedir las compras del súper, regalos, farmacia y mucho más. Globo, lo que pidas te lo llevamos. Aprovecha combos a $4.99 con envío gratis todos los días.
Nunca tuviste sueños pequeños. Por eso tienes a una universidad que te acepta como eres. Una universidad que no tiene barreras y que sabe que puedes llegar a lo más alto e inclusive un poco más allá. Ven a la UTPL. ¡Inscríbete! Sueña en grande. Innova en grande. Emprende en grande. Hagámoslo en grande. UTPL. Decide ser más. Matrículas abiertas.
Evitemos estar en contacto para volver a estar juntos. Paga de forma segura usando tecnología contactless. Además, tus vouchers no requieren firma. Es cómodo, fácil y rápido. Utiliza tus tarjetas Banco Pichincha con tecnología sin contacto. Banco Pichincha, en confianza.
Espero que ustedes encontraron interesante la entrevista con Muhammad Yunus, Premio Nobel de la Paz, y veremos ahora algunos detalles importantes sobre su vida.
El segmento cultural llega a ustedes gracias al auspicio de
Hidalgo e Hidalgo Constructores, contribuyendo al desarrollo del país y apoyando a la educación.
Muhammad Yunus nació en Bangladesh en 1940. Se formó en ciencias económicas entre Nueva Delhi, capital de la India, y Estados Unidos. De vuelta en Bangladesh convivió con los campesinos de la zona de Jobra, donde pudo ver cómo la pobreza era un mal generalizado. Observó que esta situación se perpetuaba debido a que los bancos no ofrecían créditos a los pobres que no podían aportar garantías de devolución. Ante esta situación creó los denominados microcréditos. Comenzó elaborando una lista con las personas que estaban más endeudadas. En total, entre todos no debían más de $27. A cada uno de ellos se les dio la cantidad de dinero que debían con la condición de que ellos se centraran en sus trabajos y devolvieran el dinero cuando pudieran. Esta acción derivó en la creación del banco Grameen, que ofrecía créditos a las personas más desfavorecidas y las convertía en accionistas de la propia institución. El banco Grameen funciona en la actualidad con más de 22.000 empleados que trabajan en las calles, aldeas y pueblos de Bangladesh, concediendo préstamos a 2.3 millones de personas, de los que el 94% son mujeres pobres. La tasa de devolución de los préstamos es del 97%. De 2006, Yunus y la institución por él creada, el Banco Grameen, fueron galardonados con el Premio Nobel de la Paz por su lucha por una economía más justa para las clases pobres. Y hoy fue nuestro invitado especial.
El segmento cultural llegó a ustedes gracias al auspicio de
Hidalgo e Hidalgo Constructores, contribuyendo al desarrollo del país y apoyando a la educación.
Ahora más que nunca, sabes que cuentas con tu banco para cuidarte a ti y a los tuyos. Puedes solicitar tu tarjeta de crédito Pacificard para hacer compras en línea, abrir una cuenta de ahorros y mucho más desde tu celular a través de la app Onboard BDP. Recuerda, cuentas con tu banco para hacerlo todo desde la tranquilidad y seguridad de tu hogar. Tu banco, tu casa, Banco del Pacífico.
Hidalgo e Hidalgo Constructores. Crea, edifica y construye. Kilómetros y kilómetros de carreteras a lo largo y ancho del país. Obras de riego, drenaje y control de inundaciones. Industria de la construcción. Saneamiento ambiental y agroindustria. Hidalgo e Hidalgo Constructores. Contribuyendo al desarrollo del país y apoyando a la educación.
Esto aún no se termina. No se confíen. Mantengan distancia y lávense constantemente las manos. Con mi hijo somos parte de la población de riesgo. Y yo sí quiero que me vea por primera vez. Ustedes también han de querer volver a ver a sus padres.
No te confíes. La pandemia aún no termina. Manos, mascarilla, distancia. Conoce las medidas de seguridad y los puntos de atención en caso de contagio en www.guayaquilviva.com.
Les hablo a nombre de Fundación Fidal para decirles que, si bien lamentablemente no pudimos realizar la premiación del concurso de excelencia educativa, como lo hacemos todos los años en el mes de abril, no podemos dejarles a los maestros ecuatorianos sin sus premios. Así es que hemos establecido 3 días de premiación, 15, 16 y 17 de octubre. El día 15 tendremos a los semifinalistas del concurso de excelencia educativa, el día 16 estarán los finalistas y el 17 habrá una gran ceremonia de premiación. Atentos a las redes de Fundación Fidal, www.fidal-medioamlat.org es nuestra página web y estamos en Facebook, en Twitter, en Instagram. ¿En qué pasa con siempre tenemos algún tema importante para la comunidad? COFUTURO es una fundación muy joven que fue creada el año pasado aquí en el Ecuador y que es un brazo, diríamos así, de la Universidad UNIR, de la Universidad Internacional de La Rioja, que tiene como objetivo pues trabajar sobre todo en temas de educación superior, pero en general educación con los diferentes sectores en el Ecuador.
La Fundación COFUTURO, entidad vinculada a la Universidad Internacional de La Rioja, UNIR, organizó en días pasados un evento en línea para reconocer la labor deportiva de la triatleta cuencana Elizabeth Bravo a través de la entrega de una beca de estudio del 100%.
Cuando Rosalía Arteaga y Evelyn Suárez me contactaron para revelarme que había sido seleccionada para una beca universitaria de La Rioja, me emocioné mucho. Aunque estaba un poco enfocada en mi clasificación a Tokio, finalmente regresé mis pensamientos de tierras lejanas con la tranquilidad de que comenzaría a estudiar luego de mis tan anhelados Juegos Olímpicos. La pandemia nos ha enseñado a todos. Mis planes de Juegos Olímpicos se aplazaron un año, pero gracias a UNIR, pues con la educación online no tendré que esperar.
El reconocimiento forma parte del programa Nuestro Futuro, Nuestros Sueños, que tiene como objetivo primordial fortalecer la formación de deportistas de élite ecuatorianos. Además, busca otorgarles una nueva oportunidad de una profesión y alternativas de vida tras finalizar sus carreras deportivas.
Es la primera vez que voy a estudiar de manera online y esto para mí cuenta con muchas ventajas, aunque sé que voy a necesitar los mismos esfuerzos o más que la educación presencial. Creo que este tipo de educación se adapta exitosamente a la vida de un deportista, que generalmente no llega a completar y detallar sus estudios profesionales, debido a las cargas y tiempos de entrenamiento, los famosos 24/7.
Elizabeth Bravo ha sido elegida acreedora de la beca de estudio en UNIR por su destacada labor deportiva en la especialidad de triatlón a nivel nacional e internacional. Elizabeth fue campeona en los Juegos Suramericanos en Medellín 2010. Consiguió obtener la medalla de plata en triatlón y 2 de bronce en distancia y equipo. Este año clasificó a los Juegos Olímpicos de Tokio 2020, tras alcanzar el 5º lugar en el ITU Triathlon World Cup de Mololobá en Australia, pero no participará hasta el 2021 debido al cambio de fecha para la realización del evento deportivo como consecuencia de la pandemia mundial del COVID-19.
Al buscar qué carrera universitaria podría estudiar, constaté que tienen una variedad de carreras y máster de altísima calidad. Sinceramente no sabía por cuál decidirme. Cada uno mejor que otro. Quería 5, pero tenía que decidirme por uno. Nutrición deportiva. Siempre quise conocer sobre esta área y complementar mi carrera universitaria de fisioterapeuta. Al revisar los planes de UNIR, me fascinó encontrar que tienen un crédito sobre aspectos nutricionales en entrenamiento y competición en triatlón. Conocer además sobre sustancias estimulantes, tampones y ayudas energéticas y la alimentación de los deportistas olímpicas me ayudará sin duda a llegar de mejor manera a los Juegos Olímpicos de Tokio.
Hasta el momento, Fundación COFUTURO ha entregado 3 becas de estudio en UNIR a reconocidos deportistas de élite: Sara Palacios, Guzmán Chalá, Carla Heredia, y ahora le llegó el turno para Elizabeth Bravo.
Yo quería hacer una breve referencia a el factor de la solidaridad de los estudios en línea, ¿no? El modelo, la modalidad en línea o la modalidad online realmente tiene un componente solidario que creo que no tiene ninguna otra modalidad, en cuanto que permite a mucha gente que en otras circunstancias no puede estudiar porque no tiene cerca una universidad, porque necesita flexibilidad, porque tiene que quedarse a cargo de la familia, de los hijos, porque trabaja, pues un caso claro eres tú, Elizabeth, permite poder a cualquier persona generar y tener como herramienta, como un ascensor social, los estudios en línea, ¿no? En definitiva, es un elemento que elimina las barreras sociales y que permite a todas aquellas personas que quieran que puedan estudiar, ¿no? De hecho, en la UNIR tenemos cerca de 50.000 alumnos en más de 90 países y gente de todo tipo y de todas las clases sociales, ¿no?
Felicitamos desde aquí tanto a Elizabeth como a CoFuturo por esas ganas de superación y esa bondad y entrega para que los deportistas de alto rendimiento tengan también una carrera universitaria y deportiva.
De verdad, muchísimas gracias. Esta es una parte muy importante, es una parte de mis sueños. Gracias nuevamente a la Fundación CoFuturo y que van de la mano con UNIR, la Universidad Internacional de La Rioja. Espero estar a la talla de la universidad y pues no hacer quedar mal a nadie ni a las palabras de Julito que me estaba diciendo que soy bastante responsable. Espero cumplirlo de la mejor manera y pues pronto tener el título en mis manos.
Gracias amigos, esperamos que ustedes disfrutaron de este programa y que quedaron algunas de las enseñanzas de nuestro invitado, el premio Nobel Muhammad Yunus. Él nos dijo, el COVID-19 nos dejó en tabla rasa. Podemos diseñar lo que sea e ir hacia donde queramos. La historia no suele proveernos semejantes oportunidades incondicionales e ilimitadas muy a menudo. Quiero agradecer la sintonía de ustedes a lo largo de este programa, también a los auspiciantes que colaboran para que esto sea posible y recordarle que el programa puede ser visto a través de Facebook Live, también en nuestro canal de YouTube y por supuesto hacemos alusiones en LinkedIn, en Instagram y en Twitter. Y queremos también recordarles que continúa abierto el concurso 13º de excelencia educativa a nivel nacional y 7º a nivel internacional. Así es que esperamos que visiten nuestra página web que aparece en pantalla. Y quiero ahora culminar este programa con otro relato sufí. Recuerden que ya lo hemos hecho en otras oportunidades. Son estos especies de cuentos, historias con moraleja y dice así. Le preguntaron a un sabio, ¿quién te guió en el camino? El sabio contestó, un perro. Un día lo encontré casi muerto de sed a la orilla del río. Cada vez que veía su imagen en el agua, se asustaba y se alejaba, creyendo que era otro perro. Finalmente, fue tal su necesidad que venciendo su miedo, se arrojó al agua y entonces el otro perro se esfumó. El perro descubrió que el obstáculo era él mismo y la barrera que lo separaba de lo que buscaba había desaparecido. De esta misma manera, mi propio obstáculo desapareció cuando comprendí que mi yo era ese obstáculo. Fue la conducta de un perro la que me señaló por primera vez el camino. Gracias. Estaremos con ustedes la próxima semana.